The Email Privacy Act would require the federal government to provide a warrant when asking companies to turn over consumers' email records. Next, the House Judiciary Committee hearing on email privacy. Members heard from government officials and a representative from Google. This is 2 hours and 15 minutes.
All right, we can talk. Good morning. The Judiciary Committee will come to order, and without objection, the Chair is authorized to declare recesses of the committee at any time. We welcome everyone to this morning's legislative hearing on H.R. 699, the Email Privacy Act, and I'll begin by recognizing myself for an opening statement. Today's hearing examines H.R. 699, the Email Privacy Act, and the need to modernize the Electronic Communications Privacy Act, or ECPA. In enacting ECPA nearly 30 years ago, Congress declared that the law's purpose was to achieve a fair balance between the privacy expectations of American citizens and the legitimate needs of law enforcement agencies. Reforming this decades-old, outdated law has been a priority for me as chairman of this committee, and I've been working with members of Congress, advocacy groups, and law enforcement for years on many complicated nuances involved in updating this law. I am pleased to now hold this important hearing to examine the leading reform proposal in the House, H.R. 699, and to examine in more detail the nuances Congress must consider in updating this law. While technology has undoubtedly outpaced the law in the last three decades, the purpose of the law remains steadfast. I am confident that Congress will once again strike that balance and do so in a way that continues to promote the development and use of new technologies and services and create a statutory framework that will modernize the law to reflect how people communicate with one another today and in the future. ECPA reform has broad sweeping implications. ECPA, and more specifically, the Stored Communications Act, governs federal, state, and local government access to stored email, account records, and subscriber information from telephone, email, and other service providers. ECPA not only applies when law enforcement seeks information in a criminal investigation, but also in civil investigations and for public safety emergencies. H.R. 699, at its core, establishes for the first time in federal statute a uniform warrant requirement for stored communications content in criminal investigations, regardless of the type of service provider, the age of an email, or whether the email has been opened. I support the core of H.R. 699, which would establish a standard that embodies the principles of the Fourth Amendment and reaffirms our commitment to protecting the privacy interests of the American people. However, our adherence to the Fourth Amendment should not end there. Congress can ensure that we are furthering the legitimate needs of law enforcement through ECPA reform by joining with the warrant requirement recognized exceptions and procedures designed to further the legitimate needs of law enforcement. One of the goals of this legislation is to treat searches in the virtual world and the physical world equally. So it makes sense that the exceptions to the warrant requirement and the procedures governing service of warrants should also be harmonized. It is well-settled law that the government may conduct a search in the absence of a warrant in certain instances, including when the government determines that an emergency exists requiring the search or when the government obtains the consent of the owner of the information. The Stored Communications Act, however, created a framework unique to the electronic world in which, even in an emergency or with the consent of the customer, disclosure of email content or even non-content records is voluntary at the discretion of the provider. It is also well-established law that a search warrant must be served at the place where the search or seizure occurs. For three decades, ECPA warrants have been executed with the provider because, as with any other third-party custodian, the information sought is stored with them. H.R. 699 would now require the government to also serve the warrant directly on the criminal suspect, a proposal which has raised serious public safety and operational concerns across the law enforcement community. Congress should also continue to ensure that civil investigative agencies are able to obtain electronic communication information for civil violations of federal law. Courts have routinely held that subpoenas satisfy the reasonableness requirement of the Fourth Amendment. Unlike a warrant, which is issued without prior notice and is executed often by force with an unannounced and unanticipated physical intrusion, a subpoena commences an adversarial process during which the person served with the subpoena may challenge it in court before complying with its demands. The Stored Communications Act currently authorizes the issuance of a subpoena directly to the provider, albeit with a requirement that the government notify the customer. But Congress can go further to ensure that ECPA satisfies the Fourth Amendment by requiring that any civil process authorized by the law begin with service of a subpoena directly on the customer. In this context, the customer is provided notice and the opportunity to contest the subpoena. Enforcement of the subpoena through a court order issued by a federal judge that protects the rights and privileges of the customer while ensuring that evidence of illegal activity is not insulated from investigators would afford heightened protections beyond that which the courts have deemed necessary to comport with the Fourth Amendment. Congress has enacted laws that impose penalties for certain conduct, sometimes criminal penalties and sometimes civil. We have established federal agencies to enforce these laws with the tools necessary to carry out that enforcement. Congress should ensure that in its efforts to modernize ECPA, we do not eliminate access to evidence of violations of federal law simply because Congress chose to make those violations punishable by civil penalties. I want to thank our distinguished witnesses for being here today, and I look forward to hearing from each of you on H.R. 699 and how to properly balance the privacy expectations of American citizens and the legitimate needs of law enforcement. And I look forward to working with all members on both sides of the aisle to modernize the Electronic Communications Privacy Act. It is worth noting today that we also plan to hold a separate hearing in the future on the issues surrounding law enforcement access to information located on servers outside the U.S. As with the broader topic of ECPA reform, that is an issue with many nuances that we need to carefully examine. I would now like to ask unanimous consent to enter the following items into the record. A statement dated December 1, 2015, from the Department of Justice. A letter from the Federal Bureau of Investigation Agents Association dated November 24, 2015. A letter from the National Association of Police Organizations dated November 30, 2015. A letter from the Association of Prosecuting Attorneys dated November 24, 2015. A letter from the Virginia Association of Commonwealth Attorneys dated July 10, 2015. A letter from the Technology Councils of North America dated November 30, 2015. A statement from Americans for Tax Reform dated December 1, 2015. A coalition letter signed by Tech Freedom and other coalition members dated November 30, 2015. Without objection, the items have been entered into the record. It's now my pleasure to recognize the ranking member of the Judiciary Committee, the gentleman from Michigan, Mr. Conyers, for his opening statement.
Thank you, Chairman Goodlatte, members of the committee, and our honored witnesses here for the hearing. And those who are in 2141 to participate in the listening of this very important measure. H.R. 699, the Email Privacy Act, enjoys, I'm pleased to say, the overwhelming bipartisan support in the House. As of this morning, the bill has earned 304 co-sponsors. 191 Republicans, 113 Democrats, and 27 members of the House Judiciary Committee. Now, what do all of these members have in common? First of all, we agree that the Electronic Communications Privacy Act is outdated and provides unjustifiably inconsistent standards for government access to our stored communication. This statute continues to serve as one of the main guarantees of our digital privacy, but the law was designed in 1986, when few of us used email, and even fewer imagined a world in which we could so freely share information online. The consequences of applying a 30-year-old understanding of technology to modern communications are inconsistent at best. For example, the law seems to apply different standards for government access to the same email at different points in its life cycle, when it's drafted, when it's transmitted, when it's opened by its recipient, and when it is archived in the cloud. We are not well served by a law whose application is unpredictable and that the courts have had great difficulty in interpreting. Because of the rapid pace of technological change, this situation will only get worse if we do not act. Secondly, the sponsors of this bill agree that the government should be obligated to show probable cause before it can provide a provider to disclose the content in its customer's mail, no matter how old the message is. This standard is consistent with the holding of the Sixth Circuit Court in the Warshak case in 2010. That case motivated the Department of Justice to voluntarily adopt a warrants for email standard. It also effectively ended the unconstitutional use of subpoenas to compel third parties to produce content in civil enforcement actions. Current law requires the government to show probable cause and obtain a warrant only for email that has been in storage for 180 days or less. But the government can use and subpoena for the same email if it's stored for 1 day longer. This is no longer acceptable to most Americans. As the Sixth Circuit rightly observed, citizens have the same reasonable expectation of privacy in their email before and after the 180-day mark. And as the Department of Justice testified soon thereafter, there is no principled basis to treat email less than 180 days old differently than email more than 180 days old. Thirdly, the sponsors of H.R. 699 all agree that current law is not adequate to protect new forms of digital communication. Content is content. Our expectation of privacy does not diminish merely because Congress didn't think of the medium when it last visited the statute. The law should protect electronic communications across the board, email, text messages, private messages of all sorts, and other forms of digital information stored in the cloud. Finally, the sponsors of this bill agree that we must act without delay. We have an obligation to provide clear standards to law enforcement with respect to emerging technologies. We should also recognize that American businesses cannot sustain these new technologies if consumers cannot trust them. As the committee takes up this bill, we should ensure that it does not conflict with the basic notion that the government's seizure of our email without a warrant violates the Fourth Amendment. But we should note that this principle has already taken hold across the federal government. The Department of Justice already uses warrants for email in criminal cases. The government stopped using lesser process in the civil context years ago. In short, Mr. Chairman and members, this legislation accomplishes two vital tasks. It updates the statute for modern use, and it does so without any significant interruption to law enforcement. We should all come together on this bill as soon as possible, and I want to personally thank the witnesses for being with us today and for their testimony, and I urge my colleagues to give this measure their full support. And I thank the chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Conyers. And before we swear in the witnesses, I'd like to recognize the presence of the chief sponsor of the legislation, the gentleman from Wisconsin, Mr. Yoder. Thank you for being with us today. Kansas. The gentleman from Wisconsin says he'll take you. We welcome our distinguished witnesses today, and if you would all please rise, I'll begin by swearing you in. If you'd please raise your right hand. Do you and each of you swear that the testimony that you are about to give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? Thank you very much. You may please be seated, and let the record reflect that the witnesses have responded in the affirmative. Mr. Andrew Serezny is the Director of the Enforcement Division at the United States Securities and Exchange Commission, where he has served since 2013. Prior to joining the SEC, Mr. Serezny served as the Assistant United States Attorney in the U.S. Attorney's Office for the Southern District of New York, where he was a Deputy Chief Appellate Attorney and a member of the Securities and Commodities Fraud Task Force and the Major Crimes Unit. As a prosecutor, Mr. Serezny handled numerous white-collar criminal investigations, trial and appeals, including matters related to securities fraud, mail and wire fraud, and money laundering. He is a graduate of Columbia College and Yale Law School. Mr. Stephen Cook is president of the National Association of Assistant U.S. Attorneys. He currently serves as the chief of staff of the Criminal Division of the U.S. Attorney's Office for the Eastern District of Tennessee. He has been an assistant U.S. attorney for 29 years. In this capacity, he has worked in the Organized Crime Drug Enforcement Task Force and the General Crime Section, where he handled white-collar crime, fraud, and public corruption. He also served as the Deputy Criminal Chief in the Narcotics and Violent Crime Section. Prior to joining the U.S. Attorney's Office, Mr. Cook was a police officer for 7 years in Knoxville, Tennessee. He earned a J.D. from the University of Tennessee. Mr. Richard Littlehale is the Assistant Special Agent in charge at the Tennessee Bureau of Investigation. In addition to his duties as an investigative supervisor, Mr. Littlehale serves as an advisor and trainer in criminal law and procedure, as well as the Bureau's chief firearms instructor. Mr. Littlehale is a frequent presenter to community organizations on ways to protect children online. He is active in engaging the legal community on better ways to protect children from victimization. Mr. Littlehale received a bachelor's degree from Bowdoin College and a JD from Vanderbilt University. Mr. Chris Calabrese is the Vice President for Policy at the Center for Democracy and Technology, where he serves where he oversees the center's policy portfolio. Before joining CDT, Chris served as legislative counsel at the American Civil Liberties Union Legislative Office, where he led advocacy efforts relating to privacy, new technology, and identification systems. Prior to joining the ACLU, Chris served as legal counsel to the Massachusetts Senate Majority Leader. Chris is a graduate of Harvard University and holds a JD from the Georgetown University Law Center. Mr. Richard Salgado is the Director of Law Enforcement and Information Security at Google. Mr. Salgado oversees Google's global law enforcement and national security efforts and legal matters relating to data, security, and investigations. Previously, Mr. Salgado worked with Yahoo and also served as senior counsel in the computer crime section of the U.S. Justice Department. As a prosecutor, he specialized in computer network crimes such as hacking, wiretaps, denial of service attacks, malicious code, and other technology-driven privacy crimes. In 2005, he joined Stanford Law School as a legal lecturer on computer crime, internet business legal and policy issues, and modern surveillance law. He received his JD from Yale Law School. Mr. Paul Rosenzweig is the founder of Red Branch Consulting, a Homeland Security consulting company, and a senior advisor to the Chertoff Group. Mr. Rosenzweig formerly served as Deputy Assistant Secretary for Policy in the Department of Homeland Security. He is a distinguished visiting fellow at the Homeland Security Studies and Analysis Institute. He also serves as a lecturer in law at George Washington University, an adjunct professor at the National Defense University, a senior editor of the Journal of National Security Law and Policy, and as a visiting fellow at the Heritage Foundation. He earned a bachelor's degree from Haverford College, a master's from Scripps Institution of Oceanography, and a JD from the University of Chicago Law School. Your written statements will be entered into the record in their entirety, and we ask that each of you summarize your testimony in 5 minutes. To help you stay within that time, there's a timing light on your table. When the light switches from green to yellow, you have 1 minute to conclude your testimony. When the light turns red, that's it, time's up. And it signals that your time has expired. Mr. Serezny, am I pronouncing your name correctly?
You are.
Thank you very much, and you may begin.
Good morning, Chairman Goodlatte. Good morning, Chairman Goodlatte, Ranking Member Conyers, and members of the committee. Thank you for inviting me to testify today on behalf of the Commission concerning Email Privacy Act, H.R. 699, pending before your committee. The bill seeks to modernize portions of the Electronic Communications Privacy Act, ECPA, which became law in 1986. I share the goal of updating ECPA's evidence collection procedures and privacy protections to account for the digital age, but H.R. 699 in its current form poses significant risks to the American public by impeding the ability of the SEC and other civil law enforcement agencies to investigate and uncover financial fraud and other unlawful conduct. I firmly believe there are ways to update ECPA that offer stronger privacy protections and observe constitutional boundaries without frustrating the legitimate ends of civil law enforcement. The SEC's tripartite mission is to protect investors, maintain fair, orderly, and efficient markets, and facilitate capital formation. The SEC's Division of Enforcement furthers this mission by, among other things, investigating potential violations of the federal securities laws, recommending that the Commission bring cases against alleged fraudsters and other securities law wrongdoers, and litigating the SEC's enforcement actions. A strong enforcement program is a critical piece of the Commission's efforts to protect investors from fraudulent schemes and promotes investor trust and confidence in the integrity of the nation's securities markets. Electronic communications often provide critical evidence in our investigations, as email and other message content can establish timing, knowledge, or relationships in certain cases, or awareness that certain statements to investors were false or misleading. When we conduct an investigation, we generally will seek emails and other electronic communications from the key actors through an administrative subpoena. In some cases, the person whose emails are sought will respond to our request. But in other cases, the subpoena recipient may have erased emails, tendered only some emails, asserted damaged hardware, or refuse to respond. Unsurprisingly, individuals who violate the law are often reluctant to produce to the government evidence of their own misconduct. In still other cases, email account holders cannot be subpoenaed because they are beyond our jurisdiction. It is at this point in an investigation that we may, in some instances, need to seek information from an internet service provider, also known as an ISP. The proposed amendment would require government entities to procure a criminal warrant when they seek the contents of emails and other electronic communications from ISPs. Because the SEC and other civil law enforcement agencies cannot obtain criminal warrants, we would effectively not be able to gather evidence, including communications such as emails, directly from an ISP, regardless of the circumstances, even in instances where a subscriber deleted his emails, related hardware was lost or damaged, or where the subscriber fled to another jurisdiction. Depriving the SEC of authority to obtain email content from an ISP would also incentivize subpoena recipients to be less forthcoming in responding to investigatory requests, because an individual who knows that the SEC lacks the authority to obtain his emails may thus feel free to destroy or not produce them. These are not abstract concerns for the SEC or for the investors we are charged with protecting. Among the type of scams we investigate are Ponzi schemes and pump-and-dump market manipulation schemes, as well as insider trading activity. In these types of frauds, illegal acts are particularly likely to be communicated via personal accounts, and parties are more likely to be non-cooperative in their document productions. Technology has evolved since ECPA's passage, and there is no question that the law ought to evolve to take account of advances in technology and protect privacy interests, even when significant law enforcement interests are also implicated. But there are various ways to strike an appropriate balance between those interests as the committee considers the best way to advance this important legislation. Any reform to ECPA can and should afford a party whose information is sought from an ISP in a civil investigation an opportunity to participate in judicial proceedings before the ISP is compelled to produce this information. Indeed, when seeking email content from ISPs in the past, the division has provided notice to email account holders in keeping with longstanding and just recently reaffirmed Supreme Court precedent. If the legislation were so structured, an individual would have the ability to raise with a court any privilege, relevancy, or other concerns before the communications are provided by an ISP, while civil law enforcement would still maintain a limited avenue to access existing electronic communications in appropriate circumstances from ISPs. Such a judicial proceeding would offer even greater protection to subscribers than a criminal warrant, in which subscribers receive no opportunity to be heard before communications are provided. We look forward to discussing with the committee ways to modernize ECPA without putting investors at risk and impairing the SEC from enforcing the federal securities laws. I'm happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you. Mr. Cook, welcome.
Chairman Goodlatte, Ranking Member Conyers, and members of the committee. First of all, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to address you and to give you the perspective of career prosecutors with respect to H.R. 699. And let me get right to it. The importance of the Stored Communications Act, or SCA, to the law enforcement community simply cannot be overstated. At issue are records of contact and communication by internet and cell service providers. To understand the importance of these records to the law enforcement world, I'd ask you to pause and think for a minute about how these powerful resources are being used in the criminal world. Child predators troll the internet 24/7 for children to lure them away from their parents and their homes. Purveyors of child pornography, often with graphic pictures of children, sometimes infants, being sexually molested, sell those images electronically across the internet. Terrorists boast of their horrific crimes, posting pictures of those online, and international drug dealers, gangs, and others involved in organized crime communicate effectively with co-conspirators through email and texts. When you realize how pervasive this technology is in the criminal world, you quickly realize that the evidence covered by the SCA, or the Stored Communications Act, is central to our ability to solve virtually every type of crime. And our ability to access this information covered by the SCA and to access it quickly can literally mean the difference between life and death. It can mean the difference between recovering a child alive and returning her to her parents, instead of the child being a victim of a vicious predator determined to commit unspeakable crimes. And even beyond the critical role of stopping violent crimes in progress and rescuing victims, evidence covered by the Stored Communications Act is often central to the search for truth in our courts and our ability to bring those most dangerous in our community to justice. But here are the problems with ECPA, and both of the opening statements by the chair and ranking member recognize this. ECPA and the Stored Communications Act were enacted in 1986. That was before much of this technology was in use, before any of us had any idea of its capabilities, and to continue to use a statutory framework with definitions that were enacted before any of this technology was known is just simply not workable. It does not fit. That brings me back to H.R. 699. The primary goal of this bill seems to be to codify correctly, we would submit, Warshak and the extension of the Fourth Amendment protections to email in storage and text in storage over 180 days. This is an issue on which we can all agree, but the bill goes farther. It goes much farther, and we respectfully submit, demonstrates a need for a comprehensive, not piecemeal reform. In my written testimony, I have addressed a number, but by far not all of the concerns that we have. I'd like to highlight two places where this bill creates and or perpetuates limitations on law enforcement that far exceed those imposed anywhere else in the law. Burdens greater than those related to the search of a home, burdens greater than those related to the search of a body cavity. While the Email Privacy Act expands Fourth Amendment protections and imposes a warrant requirement to compel disclosure of stored email or text, the statute does not recognize any of the well-established exceptions to the warrant requirement that would be applicable in every other circumstance. I know of no other area of the law where this is the case. Second, the Email Privacy Act also imposes notice requirements, unlike those found anywhere else in the law. The government has long been required to serve a copy of the search warrant on the person at the property being searched. And that requirement makes sense. It demonstrates to the homeowner or the business operator the authority for the search, but that homeowner and that homeowner or property owner is then free in the usual course to tell whoever they wish about it. But the government has never been required, and the law has never required the government to reach out to third parties and notify them of the search. It's not a discovery provision designed to alert those who are under criminal investigation of the ongoing investigation. And although there are specific, in fact, 2.5 pages of rules that would control when that can be extended, this simply is a rule that has never been imposed in any other context. In conclusion, I'd just like to say that criminals have, and we have seen, that they have unlimited access to these modern and powerful resources, and they make full use of them. For us on the law enforcement side to do our job, access to this information is critical. Information covered by the SCA has to be accessible to us. That access, we respectfully recognize, of course, should be consistent with the privacy protections afforded by the Constitution, but Congress should not, as this bill proposes, impose new, unprecedented, and unwarranted limitations that will tie our hands in doing our jobs. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cook. Mr. Littlehale, welcome.
Chairman Goodlatte, Ranking Member Conyers, members of the committee, thank you for inviting me to testify. I'm a technical investigator in Tennessee, and I serve on the Technology Committee of the Association of State Criminal Investigative Agencies. As you know, state and local law enforcement agencies work the vast majority of criminal investigations in this country. Lawful access to electronic evidence is critical for us in those cases every day, and H.R. 699 in its current form does not sufficiently protect that access. To give you some sense of the volume of potential electronic evidence in our cases, consider a stranger abduction of a four-day-old infant in Nashville. Over the course of an intensive four-day investigation, my unit processed and explored leads on hundreds of telephone numbers, social media accounts, computers, and mobile devices. At a time when every second counts, my fellow agents and I spent a significant amount of time simply trying to make contact with various providers to declare an emergency, calling and recalling to make sure that our process was received and expedited. We had to process hundreds of leads, any one of which could have been the key to finding the victim. Volume alone isn't the only issue. We must also contend with a lack of structure governing responsiveness. In another Amber Alert investigation, we received a lead that the creator of a posting on a social media platform may have information about the child's location. When we contacted the provider, they noted that ECPA's emergency provision is permissive rather than mandatory and demanded legal process before they turn over the records. We know H.R. 699 has a great deal of support, but we believe much of that support is based on only one part of the bill, creating a uniform probable cause standard for stored content. Advocates for ECPA reform argue that the contents of an email or document stored in the cloud should be subject to the same protections as a letter in your desk drawer at home. H.R. 699 would do that, but it goes farther to create an enhanced statutory framework of proof standards, notice requirements, and expanded definitions of covered records that would give greater protection for records stored by third-party service providers than for that envelope in your desk. And it would do this without extending any of the tools that law enforcement can use to obtain evidence in the physical world after we demonstrate probable cause to a neutral magistrate and get a warrant, like law enforcement-controlled warrant exceptions and warrant execution timelines. Bringing ECPA into balance should put the physical and digital worlds on the same plane, not favor digital evidence over physical evidence. H.R. 699 should be amended to reflect a more balanced approach that protects privacy and ensures that law enforcement can access the evidence it needs. And when we get a warrant, it should behave like a warrant, not a subpoena with a higher proof requirement. Demonstrating probable cause to a neutral magistrate should allow us to gather evidence with the same timeliness and effectiveness that we would expect in the real world. The notice provisions in the bill would require us to describe our case to targets of a criminal investigation even as we're pursuing leads. That endangers investigations. We also urge the committee to carefully balance the need for notification against the resource burden it places on us. Time spent complying with arbitrary timelines means less time investigating crimes and could compromise sensitive information. I urge you to ensure that whatever standard of proof you decide is appropriate, you also ensure that law enforcement can access the evidence we need reliably and quickly. Speed is important in all investigations, and ECPA reform should impose structure on service providers' response to legal demands. A requirement for automated exchange of legal process and records with service providers would help speed access to evidence, provide transparency, and authenticate law enforcement process. Warrants under ECPA should look like warrants everywhere else. That means that standard exceptions to the warrant requirement, like exigency and consent, should exist, and law enforcement should control whether or not they're invoked, just like we can do when executing warrants in the physical world. Everybody agrees that law enforcement should have rapid access to communications evidence in a life-threatening emergency, but that is not always the reality. Industry and privacy groups suggest that some law enforcement emergency declarations are unfounded, but those are unreviewed unilateral determinations. Isn't law enforcement on the ground in the best position to assess the presence or absence of defensible exigency in a particular case? We already do it in other contexts all the time, and there is an existing body of case law in the courts to determine whether or not we're correct. In closing, I want to reemphasize how important both aspects of ECPA are to our nation's criminal investigators. We agree that ECPA should be updated, but any effort to reform it should reflect its original balance between assuring law enforcement access to evidence through legal demands and protecting customer privacy. The balance proposed by H.R. 699 goes too far in extending all the burdens of the traditional search warrant scheme to a much broader range of records without any of the common law exceptions, while requiring us to give unprecedented notice to investigative targets just because the evidence we're seeking is electronic. Thank you for having me here today, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you. Mr. Calabresi, I think maybe I have your pronunciation correct now. Is that right?
You actually were right the first time. It's Calabrese, but all right. I'll take it however you give it. Thank you.
I'm on a losing streak here, but go ahead.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, for having me testify. That's the thing we appreciate the most. Ranking Member Conyers, members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to testify on behalf of the Center for Democracy and Technology. CDT is a nonpartisan advocacy organization dedicated to protecting privacy, free speech, and innovation online. We applaud the committee for holding a hearing on the Electronic Communications Privacy Act, ECPA, and urge the committee to speedily approve H.R. 699, the Email Privacy Act. When ECPA was passed in 1986, it relied on balancing three policy pillars: individual privacy, the legitimate needs of law enforcement, and support for innovation. Changes in technology have eroded this balance. The reliance on trusted third parties for long-term storage of our communications have left those communications with limited statutory protections. This void has created legal uncertainty for cloud computing, one of the major business innovations of the 21st century and one at which U.S. companies excel. At the same time, information accessible to the government has increased dramatically, from emails and text messages to social networking posts and photos. Most, if not all, of this information would not have been available in 1986. The technology has changed, but the law has not, creating a major loophole for Americans' privacy protections. In the face of this outdated statute, courts have acted, recognizing in cases like U.S. v. Warshak that people have a reasonable expectation of privacy in email, and invalidating key parts of ECPA. But that patchwork is not enough on its own. It continues to lag behind technological change and harm smaller businesses that lack an army of lawyers. It also creates uncertainty around new technologies that rely on the use and storage of the contents of communications. Reform efforts face a concerted assault from civil agencies that seek to gain new powers and blow a huge privacy loophole in the bill. Agencies have blocked reform in spite of the fact that the SEC has confessed to never subpoenaing an ISP post-Warshak. No less than FBI Director Comey told this committee that in regard to ECPA, a change wouldn't have any effect on our practices. In fact, new civil agency powers would harm the privacy of ordinary citizens. Imagine if the IRS had had these powers back from 2010 to 2012 when they were improperly investigating the tax status of Tea Party organizations. During that investigation, the IRS sent lengthy, time-consuming questionnaires seeking information on what members were reading, their Facebook posts, donor lists, and copies of the materials they were disseminating. While the IRS's targeting of conservative groups was limited to these lengthy questionnaires, their subpoena authority is extremely broad and likely could have been used here. If the IRS had had the power that the SEC proposal recommends be granted to all federal agencies, they would have been able to go beyond gathering information directly from the target of the investigation. The IRS would have been able to go to court and enforce an order allowing them to go directly to the ISP and seek the subject's email. While under the SEC proposal, the subject of the investigation would have been able to contest that order in court, civil standards are very low, and it's clear that the IRS had a very expansive idea of the information they could seek. This type of agency overreach is exactly why we can't grant agencies unjustified new authorities. Support for privacy reform is deep and abiding. More than 100 tech companies, trade associations, and public interest groups have signed on to ECPA reform principles. Signatories include nearly the entire tech industry, span the political spectrum, and represent privacy rights, consumer interests, and free market values. The Email Privacy Act has more than 300 co-sponsors, including a majority of Republicans and Democrats. Post-Warshak, a warrant for content has become the status quo. Nonetheless, it is critical for the committee to approve H.R. 699 in order to cure a constitutional defect in ECPA, protect individual privacy, and assure that new technologies continue to enjoy robust constitutional protections. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Calabrese. And Mr. Salgado, welcome.
Chairman Goodlatte, Ranking Member Conyers, and members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today. My name is Richard Salgado.
Mr. Salgado, would you pull your microphone a little closer to you?
Sure, thank you. My name is Richard Salgado. I'm Director for Law Enforcement and Information Security for Google. I oversee the company's compliance with government requests for users' data, including requests made under the Electronic Communications Privacy Act of 1986, otherwise known as ECPA. In the past, I've worked on ECPA issues as a senior counsel in the Computer Crime and Intellectual Property section in the U.S. Department of Justice. Google strongly supports H.R. 699, the Email Privacy Act, which currently has 304 co-sponsors, more than any other bill currently pending in Congress. It's undeniable and it's unsurprising that there is strong interest in aligning ECPA with the Fourth Amendment and users' reasonable expectation of privacy. The original disclosure rules set out in ECPA back in 1986 were foresighted given the state of technology back then. In 2015, however, those rules no longer make sense. Users expect, as they should, that the documents they store online have the same Fourth Amendment protections as they do when the government wants to enter the home to seize the documents stored in a desk drawer. There is no compelling policy or legal rationale for there to be different rules. In 2010, the Sixth Circuit opined in United States versus Warshak that ECPA violates the Fourth Amendment to the extent it does not require law enforcement to obtain a warrant for email content. In doing so, the Sixth Circuit effectively struck down ECPA's 180-day rule and the distinction between open and unopened emails as irreconcilable with the protections afforded by the Fourth Amendment. Warshak is effectively the law of the land today. It's observed by governmental entities and companies like Google and others. In many ways, H.R. 699 is a modest codification of the status quo and implementation of the Sixth Circuit's conclusions in Warshak. Two important developments have occurred since I last testified before the House Judiciary Committee in support of updating ECPA back in March of 2013, both of which have a significant bearing on efforts to update the statute. First, the Supreme Court issued a landmark decision in Riley versus California, where it unanimously held that generally officers must obtain a warrant before searching the contents of a cell phone seized incident to arrest. Chief Justice Roberts noted that a regime with various exceptions and carve-outs would, quote, contravene our general preference to provide clear guidance to law enforcement through categorical rules, unquote. To reinforce the constitutional imperative for clear rules in this area, Chief Justice Roberts concluded his opinion with unambiguous direction to law enforcement. He wrote, quote, the fact that technology allows an individual to carry such information in his hand does not make the information any less worthy of the protection for which the founders fought. Our answer to the question of what police must do before searching a cell phone seized incident to arrest is accordingly simple. Get a warrant, close quote. Notably, this committee is being asked by some today to jettison precisely the type of categorical rules that the Supreme Court held were imperative in Riley. Doing so would undermine the user's reasonable expectations of privacy and encroach on core privacy protections afforded by the Fourth Amendment. We urge the committee to reject such pleas. Second, many states have enacted bright line rules to bring their state versions of ECPA in line with the Fourth Amendment. Hawaii, Texas, and Maine have all done this. In addition, earlier this year, the California legislature overwhelmingly approved landmark legislation to update California's version of ECPA, referred to as Cal-ECPA. Not only does Cal-ECPA require the government to obtain a warrant before it can compel third-party service providers to disclose content, but it also extends the warrant requirement to communications metadata and data seized that's stored on electronic devices. States are appropriately recognizing that the Fourth Amendment protections ought to extend to the sensitive data that's stored in the cloud. H.R. 699 represents an overdue update to ECPA that would ensure electronic communications content is treated in a manner commensurate with other papers and effects that are protected by the Fourth Amendment. It's long past time for Congress to pass a clean version of H.R. 699. Thank you for your time and consideration, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Mr. Salgado. Mr. Rosenzweig, welcome.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Conyers. I appreciate very much the opportunity to come before you today to testify about the Email Privacy Act and the underlying principles of balancing privacy and law enforcement needs that are inherent here. As you know, I am a former prosecutor, having spent 12 years in various roles throughout government. I then became a Deputy Assistant Secretary for the Department of Homeland Security with significant responsibility for our counterterrorism efforts. And today I operate a small consulting company, and I serve as a visiting fellow at the Heritage Foundation. From this perspective, I am pleased to acknowledge that everybody on this panel agrees that a warrant requirement for content of email is an appropriate response to changing technology. It seems to me almost beyond belief that, notwithstanding the uniform agreement on that principle, we have been unable to work out the details of how to implement that as a matter of statutory law. To my mind, that principle has its roots not in our agreement here, but rather in the long-standing understanding of the privacy of one's personal papers and effects that goes back to the very foundings of this nation. The most famous case of which was the Wilkes versus Wood case. Wilkes was a protester, much like some of the people in America today, whose papers and effects were the subject of a general warrant. That act of search by the Crown at that time was one of the most salient effects that drove the revolutionary movement. Likewise, the writs of assistance case, which James Otis famously lost, unfortunately, in Massachusetts, was what John Adams said was the spark that lit the flame of the revolution. Today, email are our private papers. The ISPs that transmit my email to you are the equivalent, functional equivalent of the post office, and the cloud storage system that I use to store that information is the functional equivalent of the file cabinet in my office. There is no ground that I can see in that is consistent with what the framers understood our personal privacy and papers to be, to exclude that information from the full protection of the warrant. And I would add that our history of Fourth Amendment understanding has followed the development of technology by consistently applying that same principle. When the Supreme Court was faced with the idea of telephones in the Katz case back in the 1960s, they saw that those types of personal communications ought to be subject to the exact same sorts of constitutional protections. This notwithstanding the fact that, of course, telephones were unknown to the founders. And over the dissent of Justice Black, who said, you know, history says there are no telephones. If it's not in the Fourth Amendment, it shouldn't be in the Fourth Amendment. Likewise, as Mr. Salgado has said, we've recently come to understand that the cell phones in our pockets are not just telephones. There are now mini computers that contain the stuff and substance of everything that we know and understand. So too, I would submit, with the content of our email communications and our stored data in cloud service providers, whether it's Google or Microsoft or Yahoo or Dropbox, this is where we store our data today. So what's the debate? What's left? All that I hear that is left is the application of exceptions that are carve-outs and restrictions on this general warrant requirement. And to some degree, that has an intellectual appeal to it, doesn't it? Because we've had exceptions to the Fourth Amendment for a while. But I doubt that that's really what the advocates for the exceptions are suggesting, because I certainly have not heard any of them suggest that we should adopt as well the Fourth Amendment suppression rules for when evidence is wrongfully collected in violation of these exception requirements. The truth is that when ECPA was first passed in the 80s, no exception for an emergency at all. The current statute was added in 2001, post 9/11, at the suggestion of the Department of Justice. So it's kind of passing strange that we would see that exception and an expansion of it held out now as a reason to oppose the fundamental changes that are necessary in light of technology. I would submit to you that the time is ripe for change and the principle is clear. In the normal law enforcement context, police, FBI, law enforcement officers should have no more access to stored email than they do to our stored private letters. I would urge this committee to give the bill before you plenary consideration and a markup and move it to the floor for consideration where these issues can be hashed out. And with that, I thank you very much. I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you. And we'll now proceed under the 5-minute rule with questioning of the witnesses, and I'll begin by recognizing myself. Mr. Salgado, if Congress were to issue a subpoena to Google for the contents of a customer's emails, would that subpoena violate the Fourth Amendment?
That's a question I'd have to look into, is what the Fourth Amendment, how the Fourth Amendment applies to Congress. So I've not done enough research to be able to answer that with much confidence. I would say that the changes we're talking about today to ECPA would not in any way affect the investigative powers of Congress.
I think it's a very important question, however, because if you can't answer that question for me right now, answer this question. What's the constitutional distinction between congressional and executive subpoenas?
Again, I'd probably have to investigate that. The Fourth Amendment is what the Fourth Amendment is. So if there is a restriction there that's based on the Constitution, that exists regardless of what we do with ECPA.
If the subpoena issued to Google for the contents of a customer's emails, the customer might be a government employee who is acting outside of the government's servers and email system and is storing data on Google's cloud, what ability would the Congress have to conduct oversight if your finding is that it violates the Fourth Amendment?
I don't know that it would, but I do note that Congress would have all the authority it does now to direct the subpoena to the user to get the information directly.
Well, we would very much appreciate your taking some time to think about the answer to that question, because it's a very important question with regard to how we address this, because there either is not a violation, in which case the question arises, what's the constitutional distinction between congressional and executive subpoenas, or there is a constitutional violation, in which case the Congress's ability to conduct proper oversight of the executive branch is a very significant one.
I'd be happy to answer the question. I don't think it touches on the question of this particular bill, but I'd be very happy to look into that for you.
Thank you. Mr. Ceresny, critics of a civil mechanism cite to the fact that the SEC has not sought to serve a subpoena on a commercial provider in the 5 years since the Sixth Circuit's decision in U.S. v. Warshak. You've heard some of those criticisms right here on this panel today. They say it's not really a problem that needs to be solved because of that fact. Is this true? And if so, why hasn't your agency sought to challenge the warrant-only policy adopted by many providers following Warshak?
So, Congressman, the decision was made at the time. I wasn't at the SEC at the time, but after Warshak, a decision was made in excess of caution not to issue subpoenas to ISPs without consent of the subscriber. And since I've been at the SEC, we have held off on doing that in deference to the discussions that have been ongoing in Congress about amending ECPA. At the same time, we have never felt like Warshak precluded us from obtaining email under the Constitution pursuant to a subpoena with notice to the subscriber. Warshak dealt with a grand jury subpoena with no notice to a subscriber, and it did not undermine a long line of case law that exists that holds that where a subscriber or the party you're seeking an email from or seeking material from has pre-compliance review before court, that satisfies the Fourth Amendment. It is true that we have not done it, but I can tell you there are cases ongoing.
I know that you haven't done it. I want to know why.
Right. And that is because in an excess of caution at the time and in deference to these discussions, in deference to the discussions that have been ongoing before Congress about the decision of what to do to reform ECPA. From our perspective, there are ongoing investigations that would definitely benefit from ISP subpoenas where we have not obtained email from a subscriber that we do know exists, but we're not able to obtain it because we have not been issuing subpoenas to ISPs.
So how has that affected your ability to conduct investigations?
I think it has affected our ability to conduct investigations. We issue subpoenas to individuals all the time for their email, and all the time there are instances where those individuals either don't produce
to us. And before Warshak, you would then issue a subpoena to a third-party holder of those emails. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Since then, you haven't felt the need to attempt to do that and have the courts clarify this issue, which now where the Congress is being asked to clarify?
We have felt the need, Congressman, but we have, in deference to these ongoing discussions in Congress about reforming ECPA, determined not to do that. But we certainly have identified cases where it would have been helpful to do that to our efforts.
All right, let me ask one more question to Mr. Littlehale. In addition to serving the warrant on the customer, H.R. 699 also requires law enforcement to provide notice to the customer of the nature of the law enforcement inquiry with reasonable specificity. Is law enforcement required to provide such information to a person when they serve a search warrant on their home? What is the harm if law enforcement is required to inform the subject of investigation of the nature of the law enforcement inquiry with reasonable specificity? Turn your microphone on, please.
Sorry, Mr. Chairman. In traditional search warrant practice, the requirement is simply that law enforcement leave a copy of the warrant and an inventory of items seized on the premises to be searched. And in the analogy to a service provider, an entity that is in possession of evidence, we serve a copy of the warrant on them and we give them notice of the fact that we're requiring them to produce the records. H.R. 699 imposes an additional set of requirements that we actually discuss something about the nature of our investigation that goes beyond what's required in traditional search warrant practice.
Thank you very much. The gentleman from Michigan, Mr. Conyers, recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before I begin my questioning, I'd like to ask unanimous consent to introduce a statement from the gentleman from Colorado, Mr. Jared Paulus, into the record. He's the lead Democratic member on this bill, and his views are worth consideration by the committee. Can I get a unanimous consent request approved?
Without objection, will be made a part of the record.
I thank you. Let me begin my questions with Chris Calabrese. I'm trying to find out why this bill is so popular from your point of view. The Email Privacy Act, 304 sponsors, privacy advocates, civil libertarians support it, former prosecutors, Fortune 500 companies, and small businesses across the country. More than 100,000 Americans have signed a petition urging the White House to support this measure. How come?
Well, I think that Americans believe very strongly in the values that underpin this nation, that fundamental idea of privacy and a balance between what government can do and having rules around how they can do it. All this bill does is the very modest step of bringing our privacy protections into the 21st century. And everybody agrees with that. A recent poll in the Washington Post said that 86% of Americans supported reform. This panel is unified in saying that we need a warrant for email. Now, we have some minor issues around the edges, but honestly, I believe that this is a bill that would pass Congress or pass the House of Representatives by 300 or 400 votes. It is that popular, it is that common sense. I think we simply need a markup. We can work out some of these issues around the edges, and the American people can get the privacy protections that they want and they need. Thank you.
Thank you. And also in your testimony, you mentioned that the bill faces a concerted assault from civil agencies that seek to use statutory changes as a tool to gain new powers. Some argue the powers are already on the books. Why do you refer to the SEC's proposal as a request for new powers?
I think that if you don't use an authority for 5 years and there's a questionable legal standard about whether you can use it at all, it's new authority. That's simply put. It simply can't be that you have this existing authority and you say it's incredibly valuable, but you've held off on using it for 5 years. Either what you're doing is and your investigations aren't important, which we all know is not true, or you don't think you have this authority. And to me, there are really no other options, and I think that this is an authority.
Thank you. Mr. Rosenzweig, the government often conducts parallel criminal and civil investigations to the same target. What would be the practical consequences if we adopted a warrant standard for email and criminal investigations, and some lesser standard for those in civil investigations?
There'd be the risk that the exception would swallow the rule. I spent much of my early career prosecuting environmental criminal cases, another regulatory area where the civil regulatory authorities had civil and administrative powers for securing evidence. There was a set of procedures, parallel proceedings procedures, that were internal to the executive branch that governed the circumstances under which those civilly collected evidence could be transferred to the criminal prosecution side for use in a criminal case. Those rules were simply rules of grace at the discretion of the executive branch. They were not statutorily mandated, and they were not expressed in any constitutional limit. There would be at least some risk that in an effort to evade the warrant requirement that was created by reform of ECPA, criminal authorities would solicit the securing of that evidence through civil process under a lesser standard. I do not mean to ascribe ill motivation to anybody in any part of this process, but nonetheless, the interstitial pressures are very real.
Let me squeeze in one final question here. The Sixth Circuit in Warshak held that to the extent that the Stored Communications Act permits the use of subpoenas to compel the production of email, the statute is unconstitutional. Given that holding, is the mechanism proposed by the SEC also unconstitutional? Anybody want to try that in addition to you?
I think it likely is. It hasn't been tested in court. There is a history of restricting civil authorities when for constitutionally protected material. There's also, frankly, some law that points to things called administrative searches that might be seen as a validation of the SEC's position. If I were to judge it, I would probably say come down against it, but nobody makes a lot of money predicting the Supreme Court.
Could it withstand a Fourth Amendment challenge in the courts, do you think?
I would say no, but...
All right. Thank you so much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Conyers. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Wisconsin, Mr. Sensenbrenner, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In the Warshak case in 2010, the Sixth Circuit ruled the content of America's emails is protected by the Fourth Amendment. Now, I agree with that holding. Now, since that decision, the SEC has been unable to subpoena email content from service providers. Now, Mr. Kresne, I've read your testimony and listened to it. Did you write it in 2009?
No, I wrote it.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Now, if the SEC cannot currently subpoena email content from service providers, is it truthful to testify that if H.R. 699 becomes law, the SEC will be denied the ability to obtain evidence?
I don't agree that we're not able to do it currently. We have refrained from doing it in a deference to Congress's ongoing discussions about
it. I guess you kind of ignored the Warshak decision on that. Now, even under ECPA, as it was written almost 30 years ago, the SEC could only subpoena email content after it was older than 180 days. Aren't you asking this committee to expand a legal authority that was found unconstitutional in a more limited form?
We are not. I think it's...
Well, then why aren't you? Because you would like to be able to issue subpoenas on email content that's less than 180 days old.
We would defer if Congress decided that...
No. The thing is that I think the court has decided, and you're not happy with the court decision, and what your testimony says is that you'd like to expand something that's already been held unconstitutional.
I disagree. Warshak was...
Well, I disagree with you. Now, let me ask the whole panel just to ask yes or no. If Congress gives civil agencies the authority to subpoena email content to service providers, would that law be constitutional? I think Mr. Serezny has already said yes. Can I get a yes or no answer from the other five panelists?
I'd love an opportunity to explain, but
no, I'm limited on time.
That,
yes
My
or no,
answer
please.
Is yes. It would be constitutional.
Mr. Littlehale.
Yes, it would be.
Mr. Calabrese.
I believe no, it would not be.
Mr. Salgado.
I believe no, it would not be.
Okay, Mr. Rosenzweig.
No, that's what Warshak said.
Mm-hmm. Now, I think we've heard from Mr. Serezny, Messrs. Cook and Littlehale. Since you believe the law would be constitutional, how do you square that position with the Sixth Circuit's court's holding in Warshak?
Well, I think the critical distinction is the one that the SEC has already drawn, and that is that the subpoena at issue there was a grand jury subpoena, one issued with no notice to anybody. The Fourth Amendment to the United States Constitution, as we all know, has never imposed a warrant requirement without any exceptions or without any other way to meet the reasonableness clause.
Okay, Mr. Littlehale.
Congressman, I believe that the due process provided by the SEC proposal it offers a significant amount of protection, the same sort of protection contemplated by the Fourth Amendment. And I believe that the courts would view that as sufficient protection.
Well, you know, the issue is that a subpoena, you know, there can't be a motion to quash a subpoena until it's served. So even if there is an immediate motion to quash a subpoena, isn't there the risk of a constitutional violation here?
Congressman, there isn't, and that's because our subpoenas are not self-executing. If we want to enforce our subpoena, we need to go to a court and compel production.
Okay, well, except that Warshak seems to indicate the opposite. Well, you know, the thing is that here we're having to balance the fact that apparently the position of law enforcement is that they want to expand what is currently the law. And the position of those who are privacy advocates say the law is the law and codify it. Now, I think this is a slam dunk for Congress to make a determination because we already have something that everybody seems to think is okay, you know, except a few people that would like to expand the dragnet. And with that, I yield back.
Chair, thanks. Gentleman, and recognizes the gentlewoman from California, Ms. Loughran, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'm glad that we are having this hearing today. As has been mentioned at the beginning of the hearing, over 300 members of Congress are sponsoring the legislation, so it hasn't been a close call for most of us. There is a competing, not a competing bill, a bill that encompasses the provisions in this bill, but also goes to geolocation. And I'm wondering, Mr. Cook, the DOJ recently enacted a policy requiring a warrant before deploying a cell site similar like a stingray to locate a suspect using their cell phone. Does your association support that policy?
The answer to that, of course, is yes, that the use of a stingray or triggerfish cell site simulator under certain circumstances would trigger Fourth Amendment protections. That is to say that either a warrant or one of the exceptions, and there are many occasions when law enforcement uses a stingray and it does so under the emergency aid or exigent circumstances exception.
If you support this absent the exigent circumstance exception, which we're not arguing against, would you consider that a warrant for any means of obtaining real-time geolocation information should also be favorably supported by your group?
I'm not sure I understand.
For example, you don't need a stingray to actually identify where a person is with the cell phone, but the identification issue is the same. So wouldn't that logic extend to that?
Well, when law enforcement seeks prospective tracking of a suspect, as was the case in Jones, and ongoing tracking, then the Fourth Amendment is implicated, and I think Jones resolved that for us.
I think it did as well. Shouldn't that same logic apply also to historical location
issues? That's a great question, and of course, as I can tell from your question, you're fully familiar with the courts struggling with that issue, the Fourth and the Fifth Circuit, and other courts divided on that. And so part of the division, I think, is driven by an understanding of the technology with respect to some location information is that it's just not as specific as GPS tracking. And with respect to that, the courts have recognized that there's...
I don't want to run out of time. No. Assuming that the technology issues are resolved, and it's not the U.S. Attorney's Association's job to do that, logically, shouldn't the Fourth Amendment apply to historical records as well as prospective records?
The other longstanding doctrine, of course, that touches on that is the one that the courts have pointed to, and that is the Smith and Miller
third-party records doctrine.
Right, which has also been not favorably received recently by the Congress. Let me turn to you, Mr. Salgado, because we have approached this whole issue from the point of the Fourth Amendment and the Constitution and the right to privacy and the like. But it also has an impact on American business. The most important technology companies in the world are located in the United States. Can you comment on the impact, if any, on American business for a perception in other countries that privacy is not secure if you use an American product?
Thank you. Yes, I certainly can easily burn up the rest of your time with an answer to that question. It is a significant impact on American industry that there is a perception outside of the United States. Europe, it's no secret, certainly holds this perception that data held by U.S. companies is somehow there for the taking for U.S. government. This bill, the Email Privacy Act, is a good step towards getting rid of that misperception, making sure our statutes reflect the true protections that the Fourth Amendment offers.
Now, if I can, and you may not have the answer to this, but certainly this is not an issue just for Google, but for Facebook and all the ISPs, and Microsoft has a big case in Ireland right now and the like. Has anybody added up the dollars at risk to the U.S. economy on this privacy issue?
You know, that may have been done. I'd need to get back to you with that. It's not on the tip of my tongue to be able to answer.
Okay, that's fair enough. I'd like to just mention that the Chief Justice's conclusion in Riley versus California is, quote, our answer to the question of what a police must do before searching a cell phone sees incident to arrest is accordingly simple, get a warrant. How does that decision apply to the legislation that we're considering today in your judgment?
I think it illustrates the point that the Supreme Court wants us to have bright rules so that the law enforcement officer in the field knows what to do. And when we're talking about the Fourth Amendment and our right to privacy, we're not messing around with gray areas, that we recognize the significance of this right to Americans, we recognize the significance of the privacy interest, we have clear rules, and the rules should be to default to a warrant.
Thank you very much. My time has expired, Mr. Chairman.
Gentlelady's time has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Iowa, Mr. King.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank the witnesses for your testimony. I'd first, it was mentioned that there's a general agreement among the panel, I believe, and others, that except for a few people who would like to expand the dragnet. I would ask Mr. Cook and Mr. Littlehale, is there anything in this bill that expands the dragnet? Mr. Cook?
Well, so, of course, I'm troubled by the characterization.
Well, let me define dragnet so that you don't have to.
Okay.
And that would be, is there anything in this bill that expands your ability to do investigations and maybe makes innocent citizens more vulnerable?
No, sir. I think that the bill expansively limits in a couple of unprecedented ways law enforcement's ability to do their job.
And that's my understanding of it as well. Mr. Littlehale?
Yes, Congressman, I share that concern.
And you would say you would share the characterization, Mr. Cook, as well?
I believe that the bill imposes additional limitations on traditional search warrant practice, and even if the standard of proof governing an additional category of records as contemplated in the bill is given, we will have less authority with respect to those records than we would with warrants in the physical, with records in the physical world, yes.
Thank you. Thank you both, gentlemen. I turn to Mr. Salgado, and thinking of this from a Google perspective, when I or a citizen sign up for an email account, there's a long agreement that's there that I have to confess I have not studied that or had my attorney look that over, but I say, okay, I agree, and I sign up for my email, and I'm glad to have the service, and it works really good. Am I in that waiving some protection to privacy in that agreement?
Well, not with regard to what we're talking about here. The agreements certainly talk about how we use the information and where we might be needing to disclose it in order to provide the service. So it's meant to describe to you and those who are interested in knowing these things what's happening. But with regard to this bill and the Fourth Amendment, we will honor search warrants that are served on us in valid legal process.
We honor subpoenas?
We honor subpoenas, but not for content. We will honor subpoenas for what the statute says we honor subpoenas for. And it's our preference to let users know when we get these requests, unless we are informed by a gag order, for example, that we're not able to. So we will honor all of those rules that Congress has set in place and that the Fourth Amendment has established. We also will honor requests to preserve information while law enforcement goes through the effort of getting a search warrant, which may take a period of time.
Are you aware of any ISPs that have a different policy than you're describing here with Google's?
There may be slight differences in how the product works, or the policies are slightly different, but no. Generally, I think the sort of pattern I'm describing is one that certainly the larger companies here operate under.
Then practice is pretty close to the mirror of the act we're discussing, or the legislation we're discussing?
Yes, sir. I think that's right. I'm not aware of providers who are producing content on anything less than a subpoena at this point.
Then, I would burn more time on that, but I appreciate your response, and I'd like to turn to Mr. Rosenwig because I believe that you gave the clearest definition of modern electronics versus the Postal Service from the constitutional, the founders era. This is still the constitutional era. And I would put it this way, ISP equals post office, emails equal your filing cabinet. Is that an accurate description of yours?
ISPs equals your post office. Yes, that would be my summary. Or stored emails equals letters in my filing.
Okay.
Right.
Yes, stored emails. And so from could I have the right to, if I had an ISP provider that said we want to waive, will you waive your authority? While I waive my constitutional protections and hand that data over to an ISP provider, I could do that willingly, couldn't I, under the Constitution and current law?
You couldn't consent to anything, provided your consent is voluntarily and not coerced.
Right.
If the police come to your door and say, can I get the letters in your file cabinet, you don't have to require a warrant. You can say, sure, come on in.
You're familiar with California versus Greenwood.
Yes.
And so the distinction here between Warshak and California versus Greenwood, which is essentially if you take your garbage out to the curb, it's not protected by any Fourth Amendment right. If I delete my emails and they're within the custody of an ISP and I've waived my right to privacy, that would be open access then to the investigators?
I would say no. But I'd have to think about that. My sense is that when I delete the email, I'm intending not to throw it to the curb as garbage, but rather to eradicate its existence altogether. Okay. If I'm aware of the fact that a copy is kept, maybe, but I don't think I'm aware.
Okay. So it is. It's actually where we're getting where we need to go with this panel, I think, is the distinction between Greenwood and Warshak on what those emails consist of. Are they garbage or aren't they? Are they access to an investigator by subpoena or by warrant or aren't they? So I appreciate the panel. This has been a clarifying testimony today. And I thank the chairman and I yield back the balance of my time.
This time, gentlelady from Washington State, Ms. Delbene, is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I just want to thank the chair for holding this hearing, and to all of you for taking the time to be here with us today. Mr. Sresny, do you dispute the continued availability of preservation orders and court interference to enforce administrative subpoenas on targets of SEC investigations should the Email Privacy Act pass?
So if the question is whether preservation requirements should be contained in the statute and the ability to obtain from a subscriber, should that also be required?
Well, do you think if the Email Privacy Act passes, do you think that you're going to continue to have the availability of preservation orders and court interference to enforce administrative subpoenas?
I believe that that is still something that one could obtain under the proposed statute, but what that wouldn't allow us to do is to then obtain those emails from ISPs when the individual doesn't provide them to us.
So you've argued in your testimony that one problem with the Email Privacy Act would be that it leads targets of investigations to delete emails, thereby destroying evidence. So are you telling this committee that the Email Privacy Act would be to blame if you don't take the common sense step of issuing a preservation order on an ISP from day one of an investigation? Is there any reason whatsoever that you wouldn't take that step, that very simple step, which can be done directly by the SEC without a judge's involvement?
We would certainly take that step. The problem is the preservation doesn't then allow us to then obtain the email from the ISP. So certainly we would do that. We would try to preserve the email and make sure that it's available. But then the next step, that is obtaining it from the ISP, that would not be available.
So your comment that this would lead people to delete emails doesn't really hold water if they're going to be, if you have a preservation order, the information is going to be saved there. So,
but if the person deleted the email and then we subpoenaed the person, they wouldn't have it. The only person, the only entity that would have possession, custody, or control of the email would be the ISP, and we wouldn't have them have it.
If you have a preservation order, then the ISP is going to preserve that information.
Yes, but if they preserve it and we can't obtain it.
I don't know about you, but I use email to keep in touch with my family, my husband, my friends, back home in Washington State, all across the country. And I'm sure pretty much everyone in this room and this building would tell a similar story. As email has gone mobile, it's virtually indistinguishable from a phone call or a text message, and no doubt contains very important details of people's personal lives, stored in the cloud by companies like Mr. Salgado's, and we would all hope be kept safe from intruders or prying eyes. I find it highly disturbing in your testimony today that seems to suggest that the SEC views email service providers more like a witness or an informant, that you should be able to tap directly for information as opposed to the digital home of intimate communications. So let me ask you this. If the SEC wants a box of documents sitting in a target's home, can you use an administrative subpoena to bring a locksmith to their home to open the door, walk in, and take documents?
We cannot.
So then please explain to us why you think we should give you the ability to do exactly that with the digital equivalent, how that could possibly comport with simple expectations of privacy and due process. And without a shred of meaningful evidence from you so far or anyone else that the lack of this authority will have any impact on your ability to carry out investigations whatsoever.
We view the ISP as a third-party storage provider, much like an Iron Mountain provider would be for hard copy documents that are kept in a storage facility. And if in the circumstance where hard copy documents are kept in a storage facility, we could go to that storage facility with notice to the person who uses that storage facility and try to obtain those documents by a subpoena. And that, I think, is the analogy that we would draw that would be appropriate in these circumstances. And from our perspective, we do have instances in the past when we did issue ISP subpoenas where we could show that we obtained significant evidence in investigations for that purpose. As to the last number of years when we haven't used it, we don't know what we have lost, but it certainly are investigations ongoing.
I want to get your view, Mr. Calabrese, on this in terms of the role of that third-party provider being the home of people's personal communications.
Well, it's clearly our digital home. I mean, you would find much more sensitive information about me in the cloud than you honestly would in my house at this point. If you wanted physical documents, they are much more sensitive in my house. The thing I'd also like to point out that we haven't really touched upon here is that the standard for accessing information in a civil context is very low. It's mere relevance. It's not a high standard of probable cause. Also, the number of things that a civil agency has, sort of simply misfilling out your taxes, for example, are much greater than the criminal predicates for a warrant. So we're talking about a much lower standard, much greater number of ways that we can access information. That means that we're potentially opening up the cloud to much greater invasion by civil agencies even than we would by criminal agencies. And I think that's exactly backwards.
And Mr. Serezny, if you give me just a couple more seconds, Mr. Chair. You talked about cases. Can you give me the specific names of those cases?
We have a number of cases, and we were happy to provide it to your staff. It includes an accounting fraud case where an email indicated that somebody was using earnings management, an insider trading case where an email contained a tip, a microcap fraud case where the email showed control of corporations. And just one last thing to answer Mr. Calabrese's point. We would be fine if Congress established a probable cause standard as the standard that we would have to meet. Whatever standard Congress would like to establish for us to have to meet, we are fine meeting that standard. What we need is some mechanism in instances where an individual does not produce to us email and has deleted it or otherwise destroyed it.
And I think we've already discussed that right now with post-Warshak, you've never needed that authority. So my time's expired. I just want to...
General Lady's time has expired.
Yield back.
The gentleman's time expired. It's time the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Comer, is recognized.
Bye. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, all the witnesses, for being here. For anyone that can answer, if someone deletes an email that he or she has already sent out, would the ISP be able to retrieve that at some point?
I'd be happy to try answering that. It may vary from company to company. In most cases, I think it's fair to say that there would be some short period of time between the point of deletion and when the system purges the content that's been deleted. So there would be some period of time. That time period may vary from provider to provider.
Couldn't it be retrieved from the person to whom it was sent?
It certainly could. So there may be many communicants involved in it.
And I'm not one of the co-sponsors at this time, even though I am one of the persons proudest of the work that Kevin Yoder has done in getting this bill to this point. I think it's fabulous. I think it's important. My concern has been that we've left a provision at page 10, for example, that allows a governmental entity to apply for a court order so that they can still not inform the individual, and that's fine to my mind if there's a question of endangering the life or physical safety of an individual, like a child, like was talked about, flight from prosecution. As a former judge, I've signed all kinds of felony warrants, but I made sure that there was probable cause, and I made sure there was particularity in the description in the affidavit as well as in my warrant. And I felt very comfortable in 05 and 06 when the Bush administration was assuring us we would never use the national security letters for anything unless there was someone who actually had contact with an international terrorist or terrorist organization, those type of things. And then we find out in July of 07, the IG said there were potentially thousands of abuses where there was basically no case. They just sent them out. And surprised to hear this from me, but in the New York Times, there's a good article by Colin Moynihan talking about Nicholas Merrill, how he fought to disclose the contents of the NSL. And then we also, with the disclosures of Snowden, yes, he committed an act of treason, but he also exposed lies by last administration and this administration. When I saw the order, the affidavit and order regarding Verizon's disclosure of all of their metadata, I realized we were lied to by both administrations about what was being sought. We were told that, look, you don't have to worry. There's a FISA court, a confirmed judicial nominee that's a federal judge. They'll protect the Constitution. There was no particularity at all. Just give us everything on everybody you got. And the judge just signed, oh, okay, you want everything? Here's everything. I couldn't believe it. And so I'm not as comfortable with providing the exception that I'm sure was demanded by governmental entities. And I'm wondering if an excuse of destruction of or tampering with evidence or intimidation of potential witnesses enough to get an order saying we can avoid informing whoever sent the email or whoever should have possession of the email. We don't have to inform them. If we're concerned they might delete the emails, really? Well, that would always be a concern. So you could always, always, always get some judge somewhere that would sign off on that order. I know that now after seeing the disclosure by Snowden. So I'm not comfortable that this is really going to be that helpful. because of that massive gaping hole. On page 11, it says that basically the provider would have the burden of notifying the government at the end of the exclusionary notice time. The provider has the burden of notifying the government, okay, my time's about up, so I'm going to notify the subject of the warrant so that the government can do it. There should be no burden on the provider to do that. If the government wants to keep that secret, the government should try to extend it. But I'm not sure that it wouldn't be extended automatically in virtually every case. Mr. Rosenzweig, you say that we should not we've always protected men's documents, and we shouldn't change that because it's in a cloud. I would agree, but the ISPs require we check a box that says, these documents aren't yours anymore, they're mine. And I'm wondering if maybe we should have some legislation that tells ISPs, you know what, these documents, they really are the property of the person that created them, not the one who holds or provided the safe to put them in.
The gentleman's time has expired, but the witness may answer.
Anybody care to respond?
Well, I would respond by saying I share your concern about the delayed notification provisions, especially the destruction of evidence portion of it. I think that other portions, you know, risk of physical injury, harm, those are very good. I would point out that 2705 was added in the immediate aftermath of 9/11 as a codification of a longstanding common law that had developed in the courts of appeals that had adopted these various rules for when they would delay notification. So, to some degree, you're arguing with something that pre-existed 9/11, pre-existed ECPA, pre-existed this, and destruction of evidence has traditionally been one of those possibilities. That may be something that should change. As for control of one's own personal data in the cloud, I think that there are many service providers who offer different degrees of control over your information. And so I generally tend to be comfortable with the idea that there's competition in the marketplace, and that if that's something that matters to you, there are service providers who will promise that they take no interest and will not process, will not examine your data. They may be more costly in other ways than service providers who provide you. So I'm kind of a free marketist on that one.
Okay, thank you very much.
Gentleman's time expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman, Ms. Cicilline.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to our witnesses for sharing your expertise and your diverse perspectives with us today. I believe that all of us assembled here, both those of us on the committee and our assembled panel of witnesses, recognize that technology often evolves much faster than the law. This, in part, is a testament to the rapid pace of American innovation, but it also presents a gap that must be addressed, and the Email Privacy Act represents an important step forward to closing this gap and preserving privacy protections for Americans, and it's no surprise to me that it is broadly supported by the American people. I want to begin with you, Mr. Sresny. In your written testimony, you state, if the bill becomes law without modifications, the SEC and other civil law enforcement agencies would be denied the ability to obtain critical evidence from ISPs. This phrasing suggests to me that you are engaged in some activity today that would be blocked by this legislation. And so my first question is, does the SEC currently use subpoenas to obtain the content of communications from internet service providers?
We do not, where we don't have consent of the provider.
And why not?
As I said earlier, it's because in an excess of caution and in deference to the discussions that have been ongoing in Congress for a number of years about ECPA reform, we determined to hold off on using that. But it does not mean we do not believe we have the authority under the statute and that it is constitutional to use it.
But you do not currently use it?
We do not without consent of the subscriber.
Your written testimony also acknowledges that the SEC, and I quote, often conducts investigations in parallel with criminal authorities. If the FBI needs a warrant to obtain my email, but the SEC can obtain my email with something less than probable cause, what prevents the SEC from helping the government to avoid a warrant requirement by sharing my email contents with the FBI?
So the first point is whatever standard Congress establishes, we're willing to abide by, even if it's probable cause. But second, when we issue subpoenas, we do it.
Oh, wait, let me just interrupt you. So if the standard is probable cause, then your objection is not to the standard, but who makes the determination of probable cause? Because a probable cause finding with a judicial determination is a warrant.
No. What we're seeking is authority to achieve a court order with notice to the subscriber, which provides additional protections to a warrant. A warrant is ex parte, and the subscriber doesn't have an ability to object. What we're seeking is an authority to obtain an order from a court with notice to the subscriber, and the subscriber would have the ability to object and provide whatever objections they have, whether they be relevance, whether they be privilege, whatever other objections. That provides additional protections beyond those with the warrant, which is ex parte. But to answer your question about the criminal authorities, any subpoena or other order that we seek would be in advance of our investigation. It would not be at the behest of the criminal authorities. We do not issue subpoenas or otherwise seek evidence at the behest of the criminal authorities. We do it to advance our own investigation.
Mr. Calabresi, do you want to respond to that?
Yeah. I mean, I think the question that we haven't heard an answer to yet is probable cause of what? Probable cause of a crime in the criminal context is very clear. We know what crimes are, and they're, you know, interpreted very tightly. Violations of civil law are much broader. I mean, if I fill out my tax form incorrectly, or I state that this was a business expense when maybe it was a vacation, you can say, oh, I have probable cause to believe that by going through my emails, I'm going to find out he was on vacation, not on a business trip. So what we really are talking about, no matter what the standard is a much broader access to Americans' content of their communication.
And with respect to that, current law provides that the government must show probable cause to obtain the content in an email that has been stored by a provider for 180 days, but can use lesser process for an email that has been stored for 181 days. Is there consensus that this 180-day rule is inconsistent with how we use emails today? Should it be eliminated? And in addition to that, Mr. Calabresi, in your written testimony, you give a good list of the digital content we all store online, emails, text messages, photographs, musics, passwords, calendars, and other forms of social networking. Do these forms of media merit protection under the Fourth Amendment, and is current law adequate to protecting any privacy interests in this information?
Well, I certainly think that the court in Warshak believed that the Fourth Amendment should extend to all these types of contents of communication. My worry is that we don't know what the next new technology is going to look like. We don't know what the next way that we're going to keep our communications private and confidential is. And so we shouldn't be waiting. And ECPA doesn't have a suppression remedy. So these actual determinations don't come up that often. We shouldn't be waiting for 5 or 10 or 15 years for a court to find a strange case that allows them to say we have a reasonable expectation of privacy in communications. We all seem to agree that the content of communication should be protected by a warrant. Congress should codify it.
Thank you. I yield back.
The gentleman's time has expired. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Poe.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank all y'all for being here. As my friend Mr. Gohmert was, I used to be a criminal court judge in Texas for 22 years. Felony cases, 20,000 cases or more. All that time, constantly, I had law enforcement officers come to me with a request for me to sign a search warrant based upon their affidavit. And I signed a lot, and some I did not sign because of the basics of the Fourth Amendment. The Fourth Amendment makes us different than every other country on earth because of our history. It's uniquely United States history. Goes back to the British, who wanted general warrants to kick in doors of warehouses in Boston to see if the American colonists were storing demon rum that hadn't paid taxes on yet. To me, a general warrant's the same as a court order. So we have specific warrants, and like I said, I signed a lot of them. It makes no sense to me that the right of privacy is protected for 6 months, but it's not protected more than 6 months. Send a letter, snail mail, and I put that in an envelope and I send it off to one of my grandkids somewhere. It floats around in America from post office and who else knows where until it gets to grandson. It's protected. Generally, it's protected. It's a form of communication. When we use emails or store in the cloud, it's a form of communication wherever the cloud may be. So I think it's Congress's responsibility to determine what the expectation of privacy is. It's not, God bless them, federal judges' responsibility. It's Congress's responsibility to say, this is an expectation of privacy for Americans. And when we enter the digital age, I don't buy the argument, well, we're in the digital age. You got to give up some of your constitutional rights so we can have government investigate things. Whether it's civil investigation, whether it's criminal investigation, I don't buy it because the Fourth Amendment gets in the way of that. I think it is one of the most important rights that we have. So it's our duty to set up a standard. Over 300 members have signed on Mr. Yoder's bill. Hadn't come up for a vote. Ms. Loughran and I filed a similar bill in 2013. I want to get a vote on Mr. Yoder's bill. 304 members of Congress agreeing on something? Really? And I think most members, Republicans and Democrats, see the importance of the privacy. Mr. Calabrese, let me start with you. I have a lot of questions, and I only have 5 minutes. The Warshak case, the SEC lost the Warshak case. They did not appeal that, did they?
No, the case was not appealed.
It was not appealed. The SEC, the way I get it, the SEC wants a carve-out for civil investigations. The way I see this legislation, it's to protect us from the SEC and the IRS and the EPA, because without this legislation, they could keep doing what they're doing. Would you like to comment on that, weigh in on that? Civil agencies snooping around in emails, and I'm using the word snoop as my word.
We've already seen agency overreach. I mean, we saw it in this Tea Party investigation. There was no question that there was an improper investigation that was searching for a much broader category of information about people than anyone, I think, here is comfortable with. The idea of looking at what people are reading, looking at their donor list as part of a civil investigation into someone's tax status is wrong. And it disturbs me that if someone could have a relevant standard that's so low that we might bring those kind of investigations into play. I think that's a problem, and I think that's why we need to limit this very powerful authority to warrants that are supervised by judges under probable cause.
Judge, may I respond?
Not yet. You can respond in writing, because I have the same question for all six of you. The basis of a search warrant also requires there be notice. Under the current law, let's use the SEC or let's use the IRS, I like to use them better. They can do their investigation, their snooping, and the person being investigated doesn't know about it. Is that correct, Mr. Calabrese?
It depends on the circumstances. Sometimes notice is delayed. Sometimes notice is delayed. Sometimes they do know about it. It depends.
But would you agree that it's part of our fundamental fairness under the Fourth Amendment that there is a search warrant, the search warrant is executed, and that there is a return to the judge of what was seized or not seized, and eventually whoever's house was searched or property was searched, they get notice of the results of the search warrant?
This is one of the most...
Gentleman's time has expired, but the witness can answer.
All right.
This is one of the most invasive things that the U.S. government or any government can do to its citizens. You can investigate them. They can be the subject of law enforcement scrutiny. So, yes, absent some compelling reason not to notify them, I think they absolutely deserve to know when they're the subject of government scrutiny.
I have asked unanimous consent to submit questions for the record, Mr. Chairman.
You have unanimous consent to submit as many as you would like to, Judge.
And we should get the Southern rule. If we're from the South, we should get able to talk longer than just 5 minutes.
Well, we just have a better expressing ourselves and our eloquence of slow Southern execution.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
With that, the Chair recognizes the gentlelady from Texas, Ms. Sheila Jackson Lee.
I thank you so very much, Mr. Chairman, and let me thank the witnesses. I want to engage
in a give and take with Mr. Calabresi, Mr. Salgado, and Mr. Rosenzweig, if I might. But let me just ask a pointed question to Mr. Cook. Let me thank all of you for your service and acknowledge the Warshak case. Mr. Ceresny, I will not attribute your win or loss. I will just take the case as a Sixth Circuit case. I just want to ask, since that case, the Warshak case, Mr. Cook, do you know whether or not the Department of Justice has used anything less than a warrant based on probable cause to compel a third-party provider to produce the contents of a communication? Have you all adhered to that?
Yes.
Let me move on then. That was easy.
Thank you.
Thank you. To say that I come to this with a sense of trust of government, not to sense that government is unworthy and consistently trying to undermine its citizens, but I am an adherent to the Fourth Amendment and its value with the Founding Fathers. So let me engage the three of you. One, I'm going to go to you, Mr. Rosenzweig, to make it clear that issues dealing with terrorism and any elements thereof are specifically, pointedly, and appropriately excluded under this legislation. Are you comfortable with that?
Very much so. If indeed that's part of the ground for at least my personal view that this legislation is appropriate, given the post 9/11 changes that have empowered our national security apparatus to protect us in ways that I think are appropriate, it's important to exclude from the coverage of this bill those issues. And I think that's something we can agree on. And the construction provision that is in Section 6, I guess it is, of the bill is perfectly appropriate to that end.
I think it is important to make note of that. I'm on Homeland Security as well. America is obviously on alert. But we've always said since 9/11 that we would not allow fear to instruct and guide our interpretation of the Constitution. I want to go to Mr. Salgado. Mr. Calabresi, there was a law professor at Yale Law School with the same name. You have any?
Sadly, I don't.
I had his class, but you'll be favored by your very name. But let me engage both of you in the question of the value and the sanctity of the Fourth Amendment and whether or not in this interpretation of this bill, which I understand so many of us are on the bill, but 100,000 petitions are sending to the White House to support it, whether it is an obstructionist in terms of preventing law enforcement from doing their job. Can you all just engage? Maybe Mr. Calabresi will start and Mr. Gatto will finish.
Sure. I don't believe that it is obstructionist. We're codifying what amounts to existing practice and existing protections under the Fourth Amendment. We're also saying that you should have noticed when someone does a search of your most private electronic home. And to be clear, unlike a physical warrant where you get that notice immediately, we're actually delaying notice for 10 days here so that the law enforcement's got a 10-day head start. So that's our, and then we're allowing a gag provision which says that in important circumstances, you'll never get that notice. I think these are all pretty basic protections for anyone. And honestly, if there are issues around the edges, I'm not sure that there are, but if there are, I think that's why we have markups, so that we can bring these issues forward, we can take votes on whether there's anything here that we should be concerned about, and then we can get this bill to the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Salgado. Let me say that I, too, served as a judge and did a lot of PC warrants for police officers, and I think there should be a comfort. I had a responsibility to the police officer, but also to the citizens to be able to inquire what the basis of this warrant was. That layer was placed in my hands. I think the American people placed their protection in our collective hands. What do you think? What is your perspective on that? And maybe, Mr. Cernici, you might want to answer that you are not hindered by the present Sixth Circuit interpretation. But go ahead, Mrs. Salgado.
Yeah, I agree with that completely. The role of the neutral and detached magistrate in American jurisprudence is a significant one. It's something that really sets America apart from a lot of countries and gives us a layer of protection to make sure that well-meaning but perhaps poor judgment in some cases is overridden by the cooler judgment of a magistrate who doesn't have a particular interest in a case. It's significant for Fourth Amendment. It's no accident that is the standard for valid warrants.
Quickly, thank you. Mr. Ernesti, do you want to comment on that, as Mr. Yoder sits in the room on pins and needles, wondering how we're going to treat his bill?
Gentlemen's time has expired, but the gentleman can't answer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I couldn't agree more that it is important to have a role for a judge in the situation to provide objective views on the matter. And that's why the order that we are proposing would be before a judge with notice to the subscriber, and the subscriber would be able to bring before that judge whatever objections they have to our seeking the email. And that is actually the remedy that we're seeking in this case. We would try to obtain that email from the subscriber. If we couldn't, then we would go before a judge and try to obtain an order, and the judge would be the objective fact finder to determine whether we've met the standard.
Mr. Chairman, I like this bill, but I'm willing to listen to the gentleman, but I like our bill before us, and I look forward to it going to markup. I yield
Thank
back.
Thank you. The gentlelady's time has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Marino.
Thank you, Chairman. Good afternoon, gentlemen. My question here is going to be directed to Mr. Rosenzweig and Mr. Salgado in that order. You know, please speak to the trends of users moving to encrypted services, often hosted overseas in order to seek privacy, and how this might make us less safe if we had a clear framework in place. Do you understand my question?
I do understand your question. I think to begin the answer, obviously, the encryption discussion is slightly different than the one we're having now about the lawful access to content. What I would say about the encryption discussion is that it is essentially a reflection of the exact same impulse, which is that people are seeing increasingly the lack of privacy in their personal effects and papers in their, I like the idea of a digital home, their electronic home, and to the extent that this Congress does not take steps to protect that privacy by law, encryption is essentially citizens engaging in self-help and protecting themselves with their own with their own capabilities. I would say that from my perspective, encryption is an idea. It's a mathematical truth. It's not suppressible. So if we do not regularize access through things like the proposal before you that will provide comfort to citizens, they're going to engage even more, I think, in self-help.
Mr. Salgado.
I think that's I think I agree completely with that statement, and I think to the point in your question about the movement of users to services overseas, I think that's a natural consequence of the misimpression that U.S. government has such easy access to the data of providers. It's not true,
right.
And this bill will help make it clear and will help prevent the fleeing of users to other services based on this misperception.
Thank you. Mr. Cook and Mr. Littlehale, I have 18 years law enforcement behind me, prosecution, state and federal level. And as far as I'm concerned, what I've seen here since I've been in Congress, and this is only my third term, the less federal government in my life, the better. Basically what NSA's done, what IRS, and there are many more that we can get into, the overreaching and what I think the criminality that has taken place in these agencies. But being a law enforcement guy, and I've prosecuted many child abuse cases and pornography cases, if the two of you could quickly tell me what the obstacle is to you and how we can fix that, because I know in some investigations that I had, I didn't want the person who was looking at and transferring and uploading and downloading child pornography to know at this point in my investigation that he was the target or she was the target. Could you please respond?
Yes, sir.
And I'm concerned that we've lost sight of that issue and the ex-gen or emergency aid exception issue. So if I could just begin with that, the concern that we have is many of these investigations, whether it's child pornography or any other type of investigation, many fraud investigations involve dozens, sometimes hundreds or thousands, sometimes in child pornography cases, of targets. For us to get the content and then have to let the target of the investigation know is a new discovery requirement that puts the targets, whether it's terrorism or otherwise, on notice that we're looking at them. It's unprecedented, I've said that, unprecedented in our law.
What's the change that we can make? And Mr. Liddell, you go, and then collectively, tell me what the changes are that you'd like to see.
Thank you, Congressman. If all we were interested in is extending and leveling the playing field for the 180-day rule and content, this bill would be a page long. The notice provisions that you're talking about, along with the additional protections that the bill provides, are one of the great reasons that we're concerned about it. And while I certainly think that we would like to have a conversation, I think those are a little bit more than issues around the edges. I mean, that's the body of our concern about the bill is that when we get a warrant, we want it to mean something. Yeah. That's true on the earlier point with respect to encryption. If I serve a search warrant on somebody, I want to have access to that evidence. And in many instances, now I don't. Okay. Well, I want to find that access, that evidence in other places. And if it's denied to me because of delays or because of burdensome notice provisions, those slow me down. They make me less effective as an investigator. And I believe that this committee should undertake a robust review of what this bill is going to do to criminal investigators.
My time has run out. Would the two of you please put in writing and get it to me what you think could be a remedy for this, and anyone else who wants to address that as well. Listen, I am just as much a Fourth Amendment advocate as I am putting these people behind bars, and I wish I don't. No one should have to look at the photos and the kids that I've looked at and you've seen over the years and question as to why we need to have some delay before letting that person know that they're going to be arrested.
Yep.
And I yield back. Thank you.
Gentleman's time has expired. Chair now recognizes Joe from New York, Ms. Jeffers.
Thank you, distinguished chair, and I thank the witnesses for your presence here today. I want to follow up on that discussion from my good friend from the great state of Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Mr. Cook, I know you've expressed concerns as it relates to the notice requirement, and I think in your testimony, you referred to the provisions as a red alert tool that could notify an individual that he or she is under investigation. Is that right?
Yes.
And if you could just kind of walk me through a series of responses as it relates to the particular concern that you've got with the notice provision, because it's my understanding that Section 4 permits up to 10 days of delayed notice. Is that right?
That's correct.
And is it your view that the 10 days is inadequate?
Well, so I think it's important for me to point out that in our discussions already, we have drawn parallels with the Fourth Amendment as it applies in other contexts. And everybody seems in agreement that that's the goal, is to make the bill parallel Fourth Amendment protections. But this bill does more than that, and here's why. For example, if you have terrorists working out of an apartment, a third party's apartment, and there is evidence in that apartment, we get a search warrant, search that apartment. There's no obligation for us to tell the terrorist that we've gotten evidence out of that apartment that can be used against them.
Right, no, but this no. bill doesn't necessarily impose that obligation. It's a default provision, but there are steps that the government can take under exigent circumstances. I wouldn't think that it would be sound public policy to create a law that simply applies in the instance of the terrorist context, where this is a country of 300 plus million people that values their privacy rights. So there's got to be an appropriate balance between the legitimate ability of law enforcement to help keep us safe and to prosecute wrongdoers to a full extent of the law and the civil rights and civil liberties of American citizens. Is that correct?
As an email user, I could not agree more, but I think that the Fourth Amendment has already reached that balance, because
in the analogy that I've given you, when we search that third party's home or service provider, that homeowner or service provider is within their rights to contact whomever they want to notify them. There's never been an obligation for the government to figure out who's the evidence, who the evidence is going to be used against, and to notify them. That's why I say this is unique in the law, and I've never seen it before.
Now, if it, as it relates to sort of the 10 days delay, if the government concludes that additional delay is warranted, this bill, correct, provides for a court to make that determination that the notice can be delayed indefinitely. Is that right?
Not indefinitely. There's a 180-day limitation, and then there's a recurring obligation to reach back to the court.
Right, but after that 180-day period expires, the government can go back to the court and request another 180-day delay. Is that correct?
That is correct. There are narrow limitations on it. For example, one of the limitations is that if we can show that there would be harm to another individual, but there are many times when the harm could be to a community rather than an individual. And I wish I could report to you that all judges are reasonable and will always, in the right circumstances, limit that new this new statutory notice rule. But the truth is that that just isn't how it works. And expanding these obligations on the government will come with great risk in serious cases.
But there are times that an Article III judge can reasonably, or a magistrate, it's not an Article III judge, but an Article III judge or a magistrate could reasonably disagree with the government as it relates to privacy protections and potential overreach. Is that correct?
Of course it is, and there are times when that will that this agreement will result in notification to under this newly created rule to targets of criminal investigations and alert them to allow them to flee or otherwise destroy evidence or otherwise engage in bad behavior.
Mr. Calabresi, could you speak to the adequacy of this notice requirement in your view?
I mean, I believe it's a very strong notice requirement and constitutionally appropriate with a very strong delay procedure. One of the things that's I'm struggling with a little bit is we're talking about a circumstance where I am going before the judge and getting a search warrant. At that same time, I may get a delay of that search warrant. So we're not talking about some kind of separate process where I've got to go through an additional burden. When I get the warrant, I can also make the case that I must delay notice. That can happen for 180 days before a provider or anyone else, you know, notifies the subject. They have to tell the government that they're going to do that, giving the government an ability to go back to the court and say, you know what, the reasons for our delay have not ended and we need to expand it. I mean, I think it's a very reasonable, very balanced approach that supports a fundamental constitutional value, one of notice that's embedded in the Fourth Amendment.
Thank you. I yield back.
The gentleman's time has expired. This time the chair recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Ratcliffe.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As a former U.S. attorney, I'll always appreciate and listen to concerns expressed by law enforcement whenever Congress proposes changes to a law that may impact your ability to do your jobs, because you're the folks that are working so hard to keep us safe. And I want to certainly make sure you have the tools and resources and capability necessary to do that effectively. That being said, I also strongly believe that in an increasingly connected, complex digital society, our laws have to be modernized to make sure they reflect the current technological landscape. As our technology is evolving, this extremely personal information is being stored on our computers, on our smartphones, on our Fitbits, where we travel, what we eat, what we read, where we shop, who we communicate with, all highly personal information. And so we've got to make sure we've got robust protections in place for that. I certainly don't believe that the Fourth Amendment protections that we all hold so dear and the needs of law enforcement are mutually exclusive, and I appreciate all the witnesses being here today to have a thoughtful discussion about that. Mr. Chresney, I want to start with you, because from my perspective, it seems like the SEC has been the most vocal civilian agency in expressing concerns about modifying ECPA. But the SEC doesn't appear to have served a subpoena on a commercial provider in 5 years since the Warshak decision. And despite that, the SEC's annual report last year, 2014, touted a record year, cutting-edge enforcement actions, more cases than ever before, a number of first-ever cases that span the securities industry. And I know that Chairman White has testified that the SEC isn't issuing subpoenas to third-party service providers for content. So given the record number of cases, enforcement actions, and first-ever cases brought by the SEC, all done without encroaching on Fourth Amendment rights of Americans, why is the SEC asking Congress to give it the authority to get content on something less than a warrant?
Well, we certainly have been successful, we think, in enforcing the securities laws. But that does not mean that there aren't cases that would benefit tremendously from emails that we would be able to obtain from ISPs. And I guess the point that I would assert is that the Fourth Amendment is not violated by what we are proposing, which would be an order before a judge, which a judge could issue with notice to the subscriber after the subscriber has the opportunity to raise whatever objections they have under a standard that Congress would establish. And from our perspective, that does comply with the Fourth Amendment, and it also balances privacy protections because you would have an objective fact finder reviewing the situation and determining whether it's appropriate for us to obtain emails in that circumstance. And I can tell you that there are ongoing investigations now, which we have refrained from seeking those emails from, which would definitely benefit from such emails.
When you say what you are proposing, I mean, how have you been proposing it?
We've had ongoing discussions with members of Congress about these issues for the last couple of years.
Okay. Well, because, you know, from my perspective, it seems like you've been altering your behavior for the last few years in response to this opinion, rather than coming to a committee of jurisdiction, at least from my perspective. I mean, I know that when FBI has a problem, they come and let us know what it is and how we can fix it.
We've been having ongoing discussions with the staff of both Judiciary, Senate, and House Judiciary throughout this period, certainly since I've been at the SEC, which is over.
Fair enough. Thanks for that. Mr. Salgado, in your testimony, paraphrasing here a little bit, but essentially you seem to be saying that H.R. 699 is really just a codification of the status quo under the Warshak. Is that right?
That's accurate, yes.
Okay. You don't think that H.R. 699 goes beyond the holding in Warshak?
I don't think it does. I'm happy to hear suggestions, but my review of Warshak and the bill suggests that they're very consistent.
Mr. Calabrese, you agree with that?
I do.
Mr. Rosenweiss?
I think I do. I haven't checked precisely, though.
I'm going to yield. My time is about expired, so I'm going to yield back the balance of my time. Thank you all for being here.
Gentleman yields back. Now the chair recognizes himself for questions. Ms. Salgado, there's been an issue, and we brought this up here, in this emergency issue of provisions, emergency disclosure mechanisms. And Mr. Littlehill, actually, in his written testimony, that the primary emergency disclosure mechanism currently in law are voluntary. He also mentions that companies are often, in his words, unable or unwilling to respond to law enforcement's lawful demands in a timely manner. Now, I think we all would agree true emergencies are there, and as a son of a Georgia State Trooper, there's not going to be anybody that would deny the need from a law enforcement perspective. However, it seems to be implying that there's something missing here. So we did a little bit of research in our office and with others, and based on the concerns we saw that the published in Google's transparency report, based on that report, which we've looked at, it says Google received 171 emergency disclosure requests and provided at least some data in response to 80% of the emergency disclosure requests. One, I think for most people to understand it, we've looked into it, but I'd like to hear your answer to better understand that. Can you explain why Google responded to only 80% of these requests, break down those numbers for us, and why couldn't the response rate be 100% given what's been heard by Mr. Littlehill here?
Sure, I'd be happy to. I think the statistic you're referring to is in our transparency report. We've been publishing that number for a while here so that policymakers and others could get an idea of what this work is like. The number is actually relatively low, 171, compared to the type of legal process we get. The 80% represents lots of different situations where the emergency doesn't justify the disclosure. often the case is that the identifier that's given to us in the emergency request doesn't actually go back to any real account. So there are some services out there where you can create an account using a Google or any email address, and it's not verified that there is such an address. They may use that account to threaten a school shooting or engage in other some violent activity. The authorities quite legitimately will come to Google and ask us for information about this account that was used to create the account that made the threat. We look in our system and there is no such account. So the response back is we have no data to produce in response to this otherwise legitimate emergency request. That gets counted as a non-disclosure, and that adds into the 20% where there was not a disclosure. There was no responsive data. That's probably the most common situation in that 20%. There may be other situations where the request is coming in and the emergency is over, that the investigation is now actually about a historical crime. There is no ongoing threat to loss of life or serious physical injury, which means it's inappropriate to be using that authority to get the information. And we are able to, at that point, say this doesn't look like an ongoing emergency. We can preserve the information, and when you come back to us with the legal process, we can promptly disclose.
Okay, and just real quickly, but you went on with your answer long enough to bring up a question. Are you making that determination if the emergency situation is still ongoing?
That's right. The statute.
Not the law enforcement agency offering.
The statute says that we are allowed to disclose if we have a good faith belief that there's an emergency.
Okay. Mr. Littlehill, when you testified before House Judiciary Committee in 2013 about the emergency disclosure issue, you said that some providers make a decision never to provide records in the absence of legal process, no matter the circumstance. Can you identify the service providers that have a policy of categorically rejecting emergency requests in the absence of compulsory legal process? If not, why?
Congressman, as I stated in response to the question at the time, I have made a decision not to identify in the examples that I give specific providers because I don't want to highlight a vulnerability in a public forum. There may come a time when we do.
Well, I'll tell you what, I'll make a request and you can submit that in a non-public forum, but I'm really concerned here that we're making a categorical statement without categorical proof.
Well, I can certainly say anecdotally that
no,
myself
I want
and
to
agents
know. You
that
made
I work with
statement.
Have been told that by providers.
Mr. Littlehill, you made a direct statement. It wasn't anecdotally. I didn't start off by saying anecdotally providers make a decision never. You said in your testimony providers make a decision never to provide records in the absence of legal process no matter the circumstance. Now that's a very direct statement against the business practices of internet providers. Is it true? Is it not true? Do you have evidence or do you not have evidence?
I have been told that by providers, yes.
But you don't have evidence. You made a statement that is not grounded except anything and anecdotally.
Well, I would suggest that I do have evidence. I have been told that by providers.
Well, I was told that there was a Santa Claus, but I found out real quickly there wasn't.
Well, Congressman,
I mean, I'm trying to figure out
I would suggest that that's evidence. If you choose not to believe me, then I suppose I can't help you with that. But I have been told, and agents that work for me have been told that in some cases.
I'll just let that one sit. Mr. Nazy, I want to, during an exchange with Senator Leahy in a Senate hearing on this topic, you said that with regard to phone calls, you're not seeking authority that criminal authorities have that civil agencies do not. But in seeking to get access to emails without a warrant, you're essentially seeking something more than the authority that criminal authorities have. Isn't that contradictory?
I don't think we're seeking more authority than the criminal authorities have.
Okay, what are you seeking?
I'm sorry?
Then what are you seeking? I'll give you a chance to clarify that.
Sure. What we're seeking is the ability to obtain emails after we try to obtain them from an individual subscriber by going to a court and obtaining a court order with notice to the subscriber and allowing the subscriber to raise whatever objections they have before the court.
Well, I think, like I said, it's interesting that some of the testimony that's been given here, and I think, you know, it's very concerning from some issues of anecdotal evidence and real evidence and discussions, especially on the SEC side when you're, you know, giving the your own report saying you're doing more than you've ever done here, yet without this by choice or decision, however you want to do it. Mr. Calabrese, one last question for you, as my time is now over. But in dissent from the FTC request of civil agency carve-out, FTC Commissioner Brill wrote, I am not convinced that this authority is necessary to maintain the Commission's effectiveness as a law enforcement agency now or in cases that we can presently foresee. On the other hand, I am concerned that the judicial mechanism for civil law enforcement agencies to obtain content from ECPR providers could entrench authority that have potential to lead invasions of individual privacy and under some circumstances may be unconstitutional in practice. Could you speak very briefly, do you agree or disagree with his concern?
I do worry that we will create an unconstitutional or incredibly reckless carve-out for civil agencies, and my hope is that we continue to push H.R. 699 forward as is to a markup, and we can vote and get it to the floor. Thank you.
Well, I appreciate it. And so looking around and seeing how it's just me and the distinguished ranking member, this concludes today's hearings. I'd like to thank all the witnesses for attending. Without objection, all members have 5 legislative days to submit additional written questions for the witnesses or additional materials for the record. And with that, this hearing is adjourned.
All right. Good job. Okay. As always.
I'm the leading state sponsor of terrorism.